Yes, I have started.
हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. गुड मॉर्निंग किड्स. यस, नाउ आई होप एवरीवन इज डूइंग फाइन एट योर होम्स एंड बाय स्टेइंग सेफ एंड हेल्दी इन दिस कोरोना पैंडेमिक. यस, नाउ एज वी नो द थिंग्स मस्ट गो ऑन और द आवर लाइफ शुड गो ऑन, सो वी आर हियर फॉर दैट ओनली कि आवर स्टडीज शुड आल्सो गो ऑन. That's why we have started this online platform so that all of us, all the students all over the state or all over the BMC students can get with it. So we have started this online platform. Now, students, after this, I would like to tell you that since we are here for science subject. Yesterday also we have joined with this, and now today also we will be continuing the same subject, that is science one. But today our topic is different, that is measurement of matter. The subject is science one, and the topic is measurement of matter. This is your chapter 4 in the textbook. Its page number is 46. Textbook page number is 46. Okay. So, measurement of matter. Measurement means what? Whenever we go for our clothes, we give the measurement there. If we do not give the measurement, is it possible that the tailor will stitch your clothes properly? No. So, measurement. I'm using that word for measurement so that you can understand. Now, what is matter? What is matter? Matter. This word. Matter, MATTER, the word matter, which is in the lesson also itself. And I hope you may have listened this word or studied this word right from the very beginning of your primary classes. I think take it as your third standard. And there is to be one question: what are the three states of matter? And I also know that you love that answer. I also know that you have loved that answer. Solid, liquid, and gases are the three states of matter. Yeah, no? I think so. Solid, liquid, and gases are the three states of matter. Yes. Whatever the things we use in our surrounding, in our house or in the nature, everything, living, non-living, they have a proper shape. Or some are shapeless also. So that particular shape, why does it have that shape? It is because of the matter only that it consists. That it consists. So solid, liquid, and gases are the three states of matter. Let us take one example. For solid, we can take a cake, which you love very much. Yeah, you love cakes and that what do you call that, pastries and all. Kids love that very much. It is in solid state. Now, okay, you have that Coca-Cola and thumbs up, different types of cold drinks you have. That is in liquid state. That is in liquid state. And the next one, the state. There are most states also for a matter, but here I am going to tell you only the three which you are aware of. And the third one is the gaseous state. The gaseous state. Whenever your mama cooks the food and it is liked by you, immediately you go to your mama and ask, "Mom, what you have cooked? I have smelled something." That particular smell which have come to you, it is in a gaseous state. The gaseous particles, they travel all around, and in this way we can feel the in this way we can smell it. So let us now continue with the main topic of our chapter, that is measurement of matter. Now, when we'll take matter, in the previous standard also, you have studied that compounds are formed by chemical combination of elements. Eighth standard, you have also studied about elements, names of elements. At least, I hope that you are knowing about the names of the element. Let us take as one element, I will write down. then potassium. You may be aware of this. Oxygen. I know. Okay. These are the elements. These elements combine, compounds are formed. These elements combine and compounds are formed. The first topic which we will start, in this lesson is law of chemical combination. Law of chemical combination. But before that, I will show you one slide, or we'll now continue moreover with the slides only. Let us see now. Okay, before that, I would like to discuss something different in front of you. Okay, we have started with the new topic, that is law of chemical combination, which is the very first topic of the chapter, law of chemical combination. But for this chemical combination, or for these different types of features or characteristics, many scientists have earlier worked very hard. They have worked very hard. Now, these points which you can see on the screen is about Dalton's atomic theory. He said that all matter is made up of tiny particles called atoms. Atoms are indivisible. They are so small that they are indivisible. And atoms of given element are identical in mass and chemical properties. The mass and chemical properties of atom of a particular element is same or identical. Atoms of different element have different masses. Atoms combine in a ratio of small whole numbers to form compounds. Whenever a new compound is formed, the atoms of the element, they form in a particular ratio to form a new compound. And the relative number of kinds of atoms are constant in a given compound. The number of atoms, that means the number of atoms, are constant in a given compound. Now we have come through the law of chemical combination. What is the law of chemical combination says? Whenever there is a chemical reaction, let us take a very common example of water. How water is formed? Water is formed when hydrogen and oxygen, they combine with each other, and then they forms water, that is H2O. Common example. The last step, then they have combined and one compound is formed, that is water, that is H2O. The symbol for water is, the chemical symbol or the chemical formula for the water is H2O. The law states that matter can neither be created or nor be destroyed. Matter, you cannot create also it, you cannot destroy also it. In the other word, the sum of mass of reacting mixture and product form remains constant. In other words, what you can say? Okay. Suppose hydrogen and oxygen, they have combined. That is the reacting mixture. And water is the product. Both the mass of both sides remains the same. Here you can see one example here, which is given on your textbook also on page number 47. On top of it, a simple activity is given there. Activity in the case, we have taken calcium chloride, a solution of calcium chloride, and a solution of sodium sulfate. The formula for sodium sulfate is Na2SO4, and calcium chloride is CaCl2. You can see on the left side, that is the arrow. It can be seen with the help of the arrows. And we have weighed, that means we have taken the weight of that both the mixtures, and this mixture we can call it as reactants. we call them reactants. So what are the reactants now? Calcium chloride, CaCl2, and Na2SO4, that is sodium sulfate. Okay, sodium sulfate. The weight of the reactant is 300.23 gram. Now the chemical reaction has been taken place. Both the solution got mixed. New compound that is formed is calcium sulfate. The new compound that is formed is calcium sulfate in NaCl solution. Now the left one, it is the reactant, and the right one is the product. But after taking the weight of both the solution before and after reaction, the weight are the same, or the weight is the same. Again, we can understand through one more slide. Now the next one is the law of conservation of matter. What is meant by conservation? Conservation means to be there only. To be there only. In the above activity, which we have seen earlier about the weighing machine and all, the mass of the original matter and mass of the matter newly formed as a result of chemical change are equal. So, a French scientist, Antoine Lavoisier, has worked on this. He has done a huge work on this, Antoine Lavoisier, in the year 1785. Antoine Lavoisier has worked in this field in the year 1785, and he found that in a chemical reaction, the total weight of the reactant that was on the left side in the picture also, but whenever you write the chemical reaction also, you write the reactants on the left side and the products on the right side by indicating with an arrow. So he found that, and he formulated this law for us, which we can see on the screen. It is what, in a chemical reaction, whatever the chemical reaction that is taking place, whatever it is, by taking any solution or any chemicals, in a chemical reaction, the total weight of the reactants is same as the total weight of the products formed due to the reaction. Okay, we'll revise it again, or you can note down also, because it is the law of conservation of matter. In a chemical reaction, the total weight of the reactants is same as the total weight of the product formed due to the reaction. We can understand with one more example. See here. These are another chemicals. Copper sulfate and sodium hydroxide. The formula for copper sulfate is CuSO4, and the formula for sodium hydroxide is NaOH. What is this? The weight of both this solution is 60 gram. Let us take copper sulfate is 30 gram, sodium hydroxide is 30 gram, or you can fluctuate also it. Let us take copper sulfate for 16 gram and sodium hydroxide 24 gram, whatever. But it is 60 gram. After the chemical reaction which is taking place between these two, copper sulfate and sodium hydroxide, what does it give us? Copper or cupric hydroxide. Both words you can use for that. If you write copper hydroxide, that is also correct. If you write cupric hydroxide, that is also correct. It gives cupric hydroxide plus sodium sulfate. This is a chemical reaction symbolically. Earlier we have seen in an activity. Later on we have seen the law of conservation of matter. And now we are going through this chemical reaction properly. You can note down also. CuSO4 plus NaOH, that is copper sulfate plus sodium hydroxide, if they are added in any proportion, if they are added in a constant proportion, not in any proportion, so it gives cupric hydroxide, copper hydroxide plus sodium sulfate. I hope you might have understood this. Now see here, Now, in the textbook also, you can find on page number 47 only, the next topic is law of constant proportion. Of constant proportion. Whenever two or more elements react chemically together, they form any compound. In the earlier slide only, we have seen when the both elements they combine together or both the solutions they combine together, they form any compound. They form a new compound. Yeah. Mostly the different properties than the constituent element. And most of the time, their properties are different. Their properties are different. Properties means, if you want to understand, like in the earlier experiment, we have seen a solution of calcium chloride. Take us the solution of calcium chloride is colorless, no color. But after reaction, the color of calcium sulfate may be pink, may be blue, anything it could be. So this is properties. This is properties. Why I'm showing you this slide? Because earlier I told you when two or more elements react together, they form a new compound or the substances, and mostly they have different properties. I have told you about the properties also. Now suppose we want to, now look at this slide. Suppose we want to prepare carbon dioxide in the laboratory. Suppose we are preparing the carbon dioxide gas in the laboratory. We cannot take it in any proportion. We cannot take it in any proportion. Okay, bhai, 16 gram of carbon and 34 grams of oxygen. Not like that. You should use, we have to use that carbon and oxygen in a definite proportion, the given proportion. You can see here, carbon, the symbol for carbon is C, the symbol for oxygen is O. So we will take carbon 12 gram and we'll take oxygen 32 gram. And the ratio which is calculated for making the carbon dioxide gas is 3:8. We have to take the carbon to oxygen in the ratio 3:8. Now, finally, we have come to then what, why we have to take the that particular elements in a proper ratio. It is because there is also one law which was formulated by one more scientist, and that law we can call it as law of constant proportion. The proportion by weight of the constituent element in the various sample of a compound is fixed. The proportion by weight of the constituent elements in the various samples of a compound is fixed. Just now we have said, okay, the proportion by weight of the constituent element. Constituent element means, which are the constituent? Carbon and oxygen. They are the constituent. And the compound is carbon dioxide. So the proportion by weight of the constituent element are fixed. And carbon dioxide, that is another thing. We'll later count it. What is the proportion? But before combining them, their proportion should be constant. This theory or this law was formulated by a scientist, French scientist, Sir J.L. Proust, in the year 1794. His full name is Jacob Louis Proust. Okay, I hope you are going through this. Now let's come to our next part, that is the atomic size. Atom, only atom. Let us come to our next point, that is only atom, and in atom, the size of the atom, the mass of the atom, and the valency of the atom. Okay. The very familiar one. The picture of an atom. And I hope you are studying this picture from near about 8th standard or 7th standard picture of an atom. In this, you can clearly see what is an atom made up of. We have learned that at the center of the atom, there is a nucleus. And the red dots which you can see, they are the electrons. The green one are the protons, and the blue ones are the neutrons. The protons and neutrons are concentrated in the nucleus at the center of that, at the center of the atom. And electrons, they are negatively charged particles, and they keep on revolving and revolving every atom, in every element. So again, the electrons are negatively charged elements, and the protons are positively charged. Protons are positively charged, and the neutrons, they don't have any charge. They don't have any charge, but they are concentrated in the nucleus at the center of the atom only. Now we also know. See, this is one more pic of atom for your understanding. Again, here three atoms are given here. Three atoms of different elements are given here, and one by one we can see the proton is in the nucleus, and the green color electrons, they are revolving in a orbit. You might be knowing about orbit also. Yes, I know. It's are very sharp. They know what is orbit. Our kids are very good, and they know what is an orbit. And if you don't know, I would like to tell you. Now see, the electron, it will go on revolving around the nucleus, and the path which it will follow will be a circular one like, and that is what called as orbit. The electrons move in their respective orbit. And moreover, they move in a circular path only. Now the size of the atom. This pic. It is the as we know that atoms are very, very, very small. We cannot see with our naked eyes. Normal eyes. We cannot see them with our naked eyes. We need an ion microscope or electron microscope for that purpose. We need an ion microscope for this. This picture is an image of iridium atom, an element. Iridium atom, and every spot which you are looking in this, which you are viewing right now, is an atom. Every dot which you are observing here is an atom. So the atom, they are very, very small. One more example I would like to give you is about, we use board and duster in our class, and most of the time many of you kids say, Miss, I will rub the board, sir, I will rub the board, and you run through that and you start rubbing. Sometimes you play also with them. When you go on rubbing the board in the downward manner, so you can see very, very, very small, like dust-like particles there. They are nothing but the atom of that particular element of which the chalk is made. So you cannot see them. If you'll take the one atom, if you'll go on cutting that chalk, cutting on, whole day you have cut. And then the last point where it is indivisible, now you cannot cut it anymore. At that time, you can say that it is an atom. So small is the atom. So scientists have given us a unit, okay, how atom is measured. Size of the atom is 109 nanometer, or something. 1 meter is equal to 10 to the power 9 nanometer, and this is what the size of the atom. Okay, I hope you have understood. Now the next topic. Now the atomic size of depends on the number of electron. Exactly, the atomic size of the of any element depends upon the number of electron, depends upon the number of electron that are moving in the orbit, that are moving in the orbit. Now you can see what are orbits. You can see the concentric circles there. Concentric circles mean the circles which are one into one. The red color which is shown there, that is the nucleus. And after that, the circle which is, it has two electrons, and the circle which is up to it will say it as orbit. The first orbit, it contains two electrons. This is an element of sodium. This is sodium element and its atom, two atoms. In the second orbit, it has 8 electrons, and in the last orbit, it has only one electron. Now, if we want to decide the atomic size of an atom, it depends on the number of electrons moving in the orbit. More the orbits, larger the size of that element, atom. More the orbit, larger the size. The atomic size depends on the number of electrons and moving in the orbit. If orbits are more, atomic radius is also more. What is atomic radius now? You know the word radius. Circle we have studied from the very beginning of our classes, like 5th standard. When we draw a circle, we first use a point and then we draw a circle. So the distance from the point to the circle is the radius, which is common or same for whole circle. So likewise, more the orbits, more the atomic radius. This here, see here, the next atom, the element name is potassium, and its orbit. Now this you can immediately understand ki if we'll compare sodium and potassium, this one seems to be larger. Yeah, and now an atom of K, why we are using K for potassium, since potassium it is denoted by P. Yes, there is also one history which we will discuss later. Okay, now for example, an atom of potassium is bigger than an atom of sodium. In the previous slide, it was potassium atom is bigger than sodium. The reason is simple. Potassium has more orbits. The first orbit is that it has 2 electrons. The second orbit, it has 8. The third also, it cannot be more than 8. Huh? It cannot be more than 8 in any of the orbit. And the last one is only 1. And the atomic mass of potassium is 19. If you calculate 2 plus 8, 10, 10 plus 8, 18, and 2 plus 1, 19. So it comes up to 19. The atomic mass of potassium is 19. And here we can easily understand. In this way, we can say the atomic radius of potassium is greater than the atomic radius of sodium. Okay? And now, atomic radius or the atomic size, these two words are the same. When you are comparing, you can use both the word atomic size also and atomic radius also. So in this way, if the atom has more orbits, its atomic size, its atomic radius will be larger than the smaller one. Okay. Now, our scientists also, they struggled a lot for this. For the mass of an atom. What they did for this atom is very, very tiny. I told you that when you go on cutting, then how do we determine its mass? How do we come to know the mass of potassium and our sodium, common element which we use in our daily lives also? They struggle a lot with this question. It was not possible for the scientists of the 19th century to measure the atomic mass. Therefore, the concept of relative mass of an atom, relative mass, they related that particular atom with some another element, and that in that way they calculated the atomic mass number. You can clearly see here the atomic mass number. What is atomic mass number? Total number of protons, total number of neutrons, which are concentrated in the nucleus, We know that protons and neutrons are concentrated in the nucleus. So what is the, if I suppose to ask you, what is atomic mass number, then you can easily say the total number of protons and neutrons is atomic mass number. The total number of protons and neutrons is the atomic mass number. And sometimes the protons and neutrons are together also called as nucleons. They are also called as nucleons. Now, just now, some minutes before I told you, okay, the scientists, they were struggling a lot. Okay, how to calculate the mass of an atom? The mass is very small. And how could we do that? So they came for one concept. That is, okay, chalo, let us do one thing. We will relate, suppose we want to calculate the mass of a particular element. We will relate that element with some another one. Its atom with some another one. So for that, what they did, they started initially with hydrogen atom. It is the lightest element. And it has atomic mass number, its atomic mass is only one. It has only one electron, and it has only one proton. And one more thing to remember for you, please keep in mind, okay, the number of electron revolving and the number of proton that are in the nucleus are always the same. Here also you can, understand it. Okay, the one electron, one proton. So that means the number of electron and the number of proton is moreover same only. So they took hydrogen. Being the lightest element, was chosen for the reference atom. The relative mass of the hydrogen atom, which has only one proton in the nucleus, was accepted as one. Therefore, the magnitude of the relative atomic masses of various atoms become equal to their atomic mass number, proton and neutron. Therefore, the relative atomic masses of various atoms, it became equal to the number of sum of proton and electron. I have used this from your textbook only. On page number 49, you can find out different elements like hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, and everyone's atomic mass is given there, near about 20 elements are given there, and their atomic masses are also given there. Okay. Now let us come to our last topic of today's lecture. It is chemical symbols of element. Think a little. Okay. If suppose we were not knowing the symbol of any element, was it possible for us to carry out the chemical reactions? No, it was not possible for us to carry out the chemical reactions. So therefore, the chemical symbols of elements was a very necessary thing, for that. So, and the invention of giving symbols to element was initiated by the scientist J.J. Berzelius. Sir John Jacob Berzelius. Okay. So Sir John Berzig, yes, he initially worked for that. But today we are following the international system for naming the symbols. That is called as the IUPAC name. IUPAC. The full form for IUPAC is International Union of Applied Chemistry. This is a international union, you can call us union only, and nowadays which we are following the for chemical formulas, names and all, it is through this union, that is IUPAC. It is in short called as IUPAC. IUPAC, International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry. So Berzelius has initiated Sir John Berzelius, I think the name of also Berzelius. It is in your textbook also, Sir John Berzelius. So he has given us the initial idea. Of naming the symbols. He started with that. Earlier I asked you one thing, why potassium is called, why potassium is given the symbol, why potassium is given the symbol, K? Because the Latin name or the old name for potassium, old name is kalium for potassium. For what? Potassium. That is why the symbol K is used for this. Okay? I hope you have understood. Now, here I will stop the explanation, and now we will go through some question answers, or I will write on the board, and you just note down in your book and do it. It is state the law of chemical combination. And state the law of conservation of matter. Conservation of matter. And state the law of constant attraction. Okay. Hope you have understood it, and so now if you want some more questions, or if you want to ask, you can ask me. Please note down the questions. State the law of chemical combination. State the law of conservation of matter. State the law of constant proportion. State the law of constant proportion. I hope you can see the board. State the law of constant proportion. Okay. Okay, if you can, if you cannot see from the board, I will dictate you. You can write some questions over there, which you may find in this your text also. It's easy. State the law of chemical combination. State the law of conservation of matter. And state the law of constant proportion. State the law of constant proportion. Okay. I hope you have enjoyed the lecture. And still, I'm asking the students, if you have some questions, you can ask. You can ask. Since it is the evaluation time. So almost, madam, shall we stop here? I think we should stop here.
Okay, madam. Thank you.